If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
So in this episode of Mind Pump, we actually we set out to do a different episode.
Well, once
we
it's started the recording. The Bloomberg study,
article that came out.
You're right. They just getting spread around right now. Right, that went out yesterday.
Yeah, it went out and it talked about, because we were going to record a different episode, and I brought this article up, and it talked about how Americans are like for the first time ever, life expectancy is dropping and we're getting sicker while we're alive. So we're sicker during that period of time. And there's some alarming statistics that I rattle off in the episode. And then we had a long conversation about what's going on. Like, you know, we've got better medicine, more advancements and lots of different things. And yet we're seeing the rise and the explosion of all these chronic illnesses and the decline of just quality of life.
Right.
It's a pretty alarming. And we talk a lot about in this episode, like what we think may be causing it, and a lot of it has to do with, in our opinion, the quality of food. You know, the overuse or the use of chemicals like glyphosates and antibiotics, and how we think eating organic can remedy some of that. And the direction of your purchasing habits and how you're going to direct the market to kind of solve some of these problems. We do mention Thrive Market in the episode. It was a very natural, organic, no pun intended, mention, because we think Thrive Market is kind of battling the problem.
Well, they're really leading the way in this direction. I think you're going to see a lot of other companies follow suit. And so, I mean, I even think the Amazon and Whole Foods purchase is for this exact reason. So in my opinion, Thrive Market is leading the way, and what they're leading the way in is this ability for us to get organic foods at wholesale type prices so people can now afford to do it. That was always the mm-hmm. knock before was, you know, Whole Foods was known as Whole Paycheck, and it's like, I just can't afford to do that. And so they've now created this kind of like virtual farmers market type of mentality so people can now get these great foods for prices like that you would pay
like conventional foods for.
Right, so, right.
You go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, and then what they've done for our listeners is they've given people $20 off the first three orders of $49 or more, free shipping, and 1 month of a free membership, so basically have nothing to lose. Also, because we talk a lot about nutrition in this episode and how we believe eliminating processed foods maybe one of the first steps towards eating better and learning how to read your body's signals. You know, we talk a lot about intuitive eating and what that actually means, because that term's getting thrown around quite a bit now, and it's going to keep getting thrown around. And, you know, a lot of people don't understand exactly what it means. Like, what does it mean to really eat intuitively or to listen to your body? And we talk about that in this episode, but we also have a guide. We have an intuitive eating guide that breaks it down for you and gives you actionable items.
Well, first,
and
even
methods.
Even before that, we wanted to be able to give people an idea of what does that look like, and you know, what do you mean by an intuitive guide? And so, you know, Doug has set up a landing page where people can go and read the first three pages
for free.
Yeah, for free of the intuitive guide to get an idea of the message and where we're trying to help people in this direction.
Yeah, and it gives you a good idea with the direction of the intuitive guide. The intuitive guide itself comes with lots of different ways to get you towards that point where you can start reading your body signals. But again, don't take it from me. You can go read the first three pages for free. It's at mindpumpmedia.com/P/food. Again, that's mindpumpmedia.com/P/food. And then you can read the first three pages of the intuitive nutrition guide. I wake up this morning to a message, and apologize if I'm talking funny. I think I'm getting a cold. Thanks, Adam.
It's always me.
You get it first.
You sound extra sexy.
You're the gatekeeper. And then I always get it second. You notice that? He gets it. I get it.
Interesting. I don't get it. So I don't
never.
Know.
Yeah. You never get it.
Yeah, you guys share things.
I'm going to make sure you get this.
You don't share with me is what I'm getting.
We'll
here.
See about that, buddy. Yeah. I'm going to make out with you. So I get this. People send me, I used to have to search out like studies and statistics.
I know our forum now in a DM box.
It's getting hand served.
Well, because people know I'm into this kind of stuff. I'll get DM'd, and I love it. If you're listening right now and you got some cool study or something you want to share, DM it to me, and the odds are, if it's awesome,
yeah, keep us relevant.
I'll be talking about it on the show. So I get this article was just posted by Bloomberg, and the title of it was Americans are retiring later, dying sooner, and are sicker in between. So there's some new statistics coming out that are fucking shocking, dude. They're not good at all. The U.S. age-adjusted mortality rate has gone up 1.2% from 2014 to 2015, which is very rare that you see a year-over-year increase like that. But there's worse ones. I'm going to look at them here. There's people in their...
This is percentages. This isn't total number, right?
No.
So obviously... Yeah. We're growing as a nation, so, you know.
Yeah, no, it's always a percentage. It's always per capita. So otherwise, it wouldn't.
Which is crazy when you think of it like that, then, because if it's growing at that high of a percentage, you're talking about hundreds of thousands of people more a year are probably this is happening to them. That's a fucking lot.
That's a lot of people.
It's a lot.
You also have Americans in their late 50s have more serious health problems than they did 10 to 15 years ago. That's not that long ago.
Yeah.
You know, you're 10 to 15 years ago, like what has drastically changed since then to cause this? Or the other question is, are all these changes starting to cause these cumulative effects?
I think it's been over the course of the last 20, 30 years,
that's what I'm thinking.
And it's hitting them at 50 right now. Mm-hmm. I think at, you know, 15, 20 years old, all these 50-year-olds were, and, you know, that was back when smoking was cool and doing this, like eating processed shit was no big deal. It was actually becoming cool that you could just
slowly poisoning your body.
Things in wrappers, yeah. This convenience, like, and you have the rise of all the fast food and then delivery services, like all that stuff has been on the rise.
Well,
right?
here's another one.
Serving size.
When you're looking at middle-aged Americans' health, there's these surveys that they do, and there was these economists that did it from the University of Michigan. And one of the measures is what they call ADL, activity of daily living. And they'll ask them if they're struggling with daily activities like walking, dressing and bathing yourselves, eating, getting out of bed. That was at 8.8%. It went up to 12.5% in that same period of time. That's a big jump. That's a big percentage jump. Also, dementia is up. There's just all these mental disorders that are starting to get worse. And what we've seen over the past 40 years is better life expectancies because smoking has gone down quite a bit. We've figured out how to solve certain major acute problems, but these chronic issues now are getting worse and worse and worse, which includes cancer. And we're starting to see this wave that's coming. It's almost like a warning shot. You know what I'm saying? Like you're at the beach. All of a sudden, the water disappears and it goes way out, and it looks like the low tide. And then you start to realize, I think a tidal wave is coming.
There's a wall of water coming.
Right, and that's what That's what we are about to see. We're about to see that next 10, 15 years, we're going to see this huge rise in health problems, which literally threaten the fabric of our society.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is
our economy.
That's it. We won't be able to afford the cost of all this stuff, and I 100% believe.
How much longer, though, do you think it's going to take before people? Because I know right now there's 100%. There's at least a few thousand people right now. I heard you say that and think right away like, oh, Chicken Little, you know, like, oh, the sky is falling.
Yeah.
Because a little bit of percentage of this or that, it could be attributed to this, could be attributed to that. Like, oh, it'll even itself.
It's compounding,
right?
It's a compounding thing, especially when you consider these.
No, I know, but when do you think? How much further do you think we have to go before people go like, oh, fuck, this is getting really bad.
I think...
Because because this is our space, right? So we feel like, oh, it's the culture's changing. There's paleo this now, and there's ketogenic, you know, talking about this. And it's like, as soon as you step out of that, like, and just talk to normal people who don't, like, exercise every day, which is a majority of everybody else, like, they don't give a fuck. They're not talking about this.
Oh, yeah, I go to a gas station. People are still, like, buying, like, shitty soda and candy as like a snack, you know, like it's just like we totally are in a bubble. We're in a little sphere of like hope, you know, and like you do see organics and you do see like Whole Food kind of, you know, Whole Foods making more presence in the market. But it's just like there's just so many people that it's not affecting.
It's a tough ship to turn because we've been told for so long that the problem is underactivity and overeating, that that's all the problem. Now, that's definitely part of this, that's part of the problem. But there's a lot more that's going on. I mean,
well, I even think you can say it's a big part of the problem. It's most of the problem, right? For sure. And this is where I always kind of agree with Lane, where Lane takes this approach that absolutely, when you look at all the markers that make the biggest difference on your overall or general health, overconsumption and under moving, right, is for sure the biggest killer.
So,
but food quality is fucking coming real close.
Well,
dude.
So here's the part that's crazy to me, because I'm starting to, I haven't changed my mind yet. I still agree with you, but the other side is starting to convince me.
I'm the same way.
When I talk
I'm
to
in the same place.
I talked to Chris Kressers, Rob Wolf. You know, I talked to Dr. Zach Bush, which is a recent interview that hasn't aired yet. And you know, like Dr. Zach Bush, triple board certified, physician, which is very rare, super, super intelligent. And he's telling me the research he's doing. He's telling me things like glyphosates are damaging the fabric that gives us the integrity of our cell walls, of our intestines, of our blood vessels. He's talking about how antibiotics, it takes a while for these things to cause these problems. It takes generations, but we're seeing...
Which is why they pass all the tests from like FDA and stuff like that to get approved and go right now, because... You know, 6 months of it, you know, or even a year of taking it, it's not going to kill anybody.
That's right.
But it is altering your chemistry and your makeup. And so much of the stuff that we've been doing over the last 30 years, I think it's just the combination of all of it that is why we're seeing this rise.
Well, I'll give you an example. So I just learned about how glyphosates kill plants, because that's what they're used for, right? They're used as herbicides, kill all these, these plants. They operate...
Kill the plants or... kill off all the bugs that are trying to kill the
plants.
No.
Glyphosate's an herbicide. Yeah. It's not a pesticide, right? There's pesticides as herbicides. So what glyphosates do is you spray them on a plant and it interrupts what's called the Shikimati, I believe, if I'm pronouncing it right, pathway, which is a crucial pathway that tells plants how to produce amino acids and whatnot. Now, humans don't have this pathway, which is why they're like, oh, it's safe. It's safe for humans. It doesn't affect this because we don't have this pathway in us. However, plants have them, bacteria have them, and because of that, we're producing plants that are, with GMO plants and stuff like that, we are producing situations where the soil doesn't have...
certain bacteria.
Well, not just bacteria, because that's a big one, right? Because you're consuming glyphosate residues, which are everywhere. I think 75%, the last test showed that 75% of rainwater has got glyphosates in it, regardless of where you live or whatever. More if you live near where they spray lots of plants.
Means even organics a little fucked.
organic plants will many times have some glyphosate residues, of course, much less than non-organic, but it's because it fucking rains on everything. And this totally disrupts your microbiome and your gut. It also...
Right, we're made up of bacteria.
Yeah,
so.
Yep, and they're also showing that glyphosates themselves damage the intestinal permeability. That the soil is being stripped of these organic molecules, which we never really paid attention to, because all we pay attention to are, you know, nitrogen and phosphorus and these types of nutrients. But there are other things in soil that bacteria use to communicate with each other, that your cells use to communicate with bacteria back and forth, that we no longer have. So our bodies aren't repairing fast enough to deal with some of this damage. And so over time, and it takes a long time for this to happen, this is the problem. The problem is, if you consume these things, you don't get an acute reaction. You don't even get a reaction within 5 or 10 years. But over the course of your lifetime, and then over generational, you know, over the generations, you start to see problems where now we're getting all these weird chronic illnesses all the time. Like, there's certain cancer rates that are going up in children that were pretty rare. You know, diabetes in kids is like through the roof, compared to what it used to be non-existent. Alzheimer's is happening in people younger and younger. You know, glyphosates, by the way, they potentially can pass through the blood-brain barrier because they are water-soluble, and they do, again, they destroy those barriers that we have in our body that are so important in keeping things that are bad for us out and letting things that are good for us in. So food quality, maybe, I mean, a lot of people are arguing it's more important than just the quantity. And then on the other argument that tends to win me over with that is this. When you are eating these foods that are processed and engineered, then it's very difficult to manage quantity. You know what I'm saying? It's much harder to, Like, I bet you...
No matter what, you're right on that. I mean, it's just that the Chris Kresser, when he talked about the baked potato...
Yeah, versus potato chips, right?
Right. It's such a true, easy way anybody can test that theory out, just right there by itself. Like, get a bag of potato chips, get as many baked potatoes as you want, and see which one you'll get to 1,000 or 10,000 calories to first, you know?
Yeah.
And it's actually very realistic you could get to 10,000 calories eating a couple bags of chips. Yeah. I know I could do that. I'm sure in my lifetime I've done it at least once or twice.
Yeah.
But I know I've never tried.
Yeah, a plain
but I know
potato?
Like mindlessly eat.
But I know I wouldn't be able to do. I remember when I was competing, I would actually eat some plain baked potatoes, and
with nothing on them.
Yeah, because it was part of like so. I used this in peak week because, you know, I'm in a caloric deficit a lot, so I'm always basically hungry. I mean, when you're catabolic like that, I'm hungry all the time. So actually eating white potatoes like that was a great way to satiate myself because it actually, one of them, just eating dry with like a chicken or a steak or something like that, oh my God, I would be stuffed afterwards. I couldn't imagine myself, even being someone who was in a hungry state all the time, I couldn't imagine eating two or three of those meals back to back because it was such a
filler. It's palate fatigue.
Yeah.
And we circumvent that. So it's almost like if we took a bunch of people who had problems with their weight and all we did, we didn't tell them, you know, control your calories, control your macros. Like, we didn't say any of that stuff. If all we did was say, okay, you're not allowed to eat anything that is packaged or processed. You have to eat very basic foods and then see what happens, I bet you would have more success doing that than telling these people over here,
oh yeah,
watch your calories and macros, because naturally you're not going to want to overeat for the most part.
Yeah, it's challenging to consume that many calories when you have like that raw, whole natural type foods that are really fibrous and it's hard to get through. And the thing is, it's like, you know, these foods, I mean, they're hard to digest. Like, it takes a while to kind of get through it. And I feel like, you know, we've bypassed that whole process and made it so accessible that we could cram way more food in that way. So it just makes a lot of sense.
How do you guys take this information though now? And like, imagine like all the people that we've coached and trained and, you know, they've been eating a certain way for so long and some of them in decent shape. And like, how do you take, because it's really
fucking tough, man.
This is such a hard conversation.
Because I guarantee you, I'm blowing people right now. If you're listening for the first few times or whatever, or you're early in this journey, I'm probably blowing you out of the water. You're probably like, well, fuck it. I don't want to do anything because everything is bad for me. Right.
Right.
I'm always changing my approach, you know, with like somebody new coming in, like because of how much we learn, you know, about all these different processes of like, you know, what's going to be the biggest mover right now. And like, you know, sleep being on, you know, one of the highest things now that I'm focused on that between and then the whole foods thing and adding food in there that's like more nutrient dense and fibrous and approaching it from that perspective as opposed to like starting to take away foods and getting them, you know, getting all these like highly processed things out. It's you know, introducing first. That's totally a new approach for me.
Yeah, I think that's a good strategy, and I think that's worked for me better now that I've kind of implemented that too. It's like, okay, instead of like telling myself, oh, I can't ever have this thing that I in my life that I know isn't ideal for me. Like, say I had this Pop-Tart addiction, or use Diet Cokes for example for me, because I like Diet Coke. If there's something that I allow in and out of my life a lot that I know is not ideal for my body, it would be my Diet Cokes. And so, you know, I still, instead of thinking like, oh my God, I got to just eliminate that for the rest of my life because it's not good, it's not ideal for my body, it's like, okay, well, there's a lot of other areas in my health and wellness journey that I should be practicing that are even bigger rocks than just that. And so focusing on getting those in there. And then when I'm really got good momentum, that's in place. I'm sleeping really good. Exercise is right. My diet's on point. Now I'm even eliminating and cutting back on some of these, restricting on these Cokes. So I kind of teach that to people. It's like, instead of letting some like information or a study like that freak you out and be like, oh my God, can't have anything now because even organic foods got shit on it. Yeah. Freak out. It's like, no, you still have to evaluate your own journey and where you're currently at and look at the big rocks and look at, you know, what are the things that you're doing right now that are probably not ideal for it, or the things that, because let's be honest too, like it's not the one Diet Coke, it's not the one piece of processed food that you have that's killing you. It's probably the things that you're addicted to or the things that you are over consuming a lot of and for long periods of time. That's what's really
it's
hurting.
It's the chronic things.
Right.
Yeah. Everything you have to assess what those things are. Like, what are my chronic habits? What's what am I introducing to my body the most frequently?
The reality is, I mean, we've constructed a society around solving, at the time, solving the things that threatened us the most, solving the issues of infection, solving the issues of, you know, not enough food or malnutrition because we don't have, because we're lacking vitamins and minerals, solving, you know, viruses through, you know, through the invention of vaccines, you know, solving, you know, being able to have like emergency surgeries. So we've been able to solve those problems. We've constructed the society around it. The problem is we've had some now unintended consequences of it. So now we're walking around a society that's like everything contains certain things that are probably not good for you long term. There's pitfalls everywhere you look, and that's okay. Don't freak out. Like Adam's saying, identify the big things and make those big changes before you move on to some of the smaller changes. And it is a challenge. Unfortunately, it's you can't live easy, in the sense that the way everything's designed to make things easy for you, with here, eat this, it's so easy. You don't have to refrigerate it. You can store it forever. And here, microwave this. You don't need to prepare anything. And oh, this is super cheap because we figured out a way to grow it in a way that makes it super cheap. Like, you might have to make things a little bit more difficult for yourself, but in the long term, I think it'll make things easier anyway, because I can't imagine. I mean, I've seen people in chronic illness, and I've dealt with some of my own stuff, and that's very, very tough. That's a very tough thing to deal with, and I'm afraid that we're just starting to see this surge, because the baby boomers are all becoming older,
yeah.
And that's the biggest percentage of the population. So that's when I say bankrupt, that's what I mean. We have this huge percent of the population that's going into the ages now that get expensive, and the ones that support it are the taxpayers, and are we going to have enough?
What year did you think this got really crazy? Like, when you think of like processed foods, and you think of, you know, fast food and serving size and all the, what year do you think did it really start to explode? Or do you think it's been compounding every single year? And like, when do you think?
It's been compounding. So like glyphosates, for example.
Because in 1930, this wasn't a big discussion.
No, not at all. So glyphosates were introduced in the market, I believe, 1972. They weren't really being heavily used in the U.S. until the 90s. And then the patent on them, which was held by Monsanto, I believe ended sometime in the early 2000s. And now you've got major, huge biotech companies that produce it. I think China now.
Who did Monsanto just buy like 2 years ago?
Was it Bayer?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So break that
two
down.
Two companies with evil backgrounds.
Name. Didn't they change their name?
Yeah, you know that Bayer was responsible for the gas in the... Yeah, they were the...
In the concentration camp.
Yes.
Yeah, Bayer and Monsanto do not have the best... That.
Crazy.
They don't have the best history. Do you know Monsanto used to make...
Creepy.
They made Agent Orange, which we would spray all over the jungle and fucking, you know, Vietnam War, and all of our soldiers came back with all kinds of neurological disorders.
Think about that.
Shit.
Those two companies now have aligned.
Yeah.
And I think of how much power they have with
it started with.
And I know some people roll their eyes, think conspiracy theory.
Yeah,
it's
the
like,
axis is
I
evil.
Don't think conspiracy theory. I think you're more of an idiot if you think otherwise. Two companies that have got that much.
They have great motives now.
Yeah,
you
right.
Know, they're really positive.
Yeah.
No, you know what's funny?
Team Human.
So in the post-World War II, we had this boost of agriculture. Because biotech companies discovered that if you just sprayed nitrates, you know, from petroleum into the soil, you could make your plants green and you can make them grow. They're like, oh shit, now we don't have to worry about this eroding topsoil, because before that they would have like the dust bowl and, you know, areas where plants wouldn't grow because we'd fucking deplete the shit out of the soil. So instead of like becoming responsible with it, they're like, oh cool, spray the shit out of everything with nitrates. We're going to grow these plants.
Typical Americans.
Typical. And then what happened is, because of that, when, and you've talked about this growing marijuana, when you grow plants that are off, nutrient deficient, and you know they're not balanced, they get attacked by pests a lot. They become very, very susceptible to attack from molds, from funguses, and from pests. So now we're like, what do we do now? Like, all these weeds are killing our plants.
Now we got to like zap the pests.
So now synthetic pesticide inventions went through the roof, and then glyphosates become invented as a way to control weeds. Mm. So it's like we're fixing a problem that we created that was
And that's Western medicine, ladies and gentlemen.
With more synthetic shit rather than saying, take a step back.
Keep treating the symptoms.
Yeah, let's see what we can do here.
And it's really only done because of mass farming. I mean, that's where you need that, right? Because it's like they probably increased their crops by, I would I would guess over 50%. I know what we would deal with plants mm-hmm. dying off, like if you weren't that attentive to it, if you didn't have the ability to give each one its individual attention, which you can't do that with corn, right? You see cornfields, like there's not a farmer who walks out in these cornfields of a million rows and like looks at each plant, takes care of it. And like that's what it kind of takes. It's like the human body and the plant are very similar with homeostasis. Like the little bit of off of any way and it's susceptible, right?
It gets attacked.
Yeah, not enough water, too much water, not enough nutrients, too much nutrients, weather change, not enough sunshine yeah. getting on it, plant on shading on it. You know what I'm saying? Like there's so many variables that could stress this plant out to now make it susceptible to getting mold, insects, whatever mm-hmm. critters that will attack it. And then it just spreads like wildfire. So I bet the introduction of this had to do more than well over 50% saving or multiplying their crops. And it's 100%.
It did. And you know, it's funny because
super valuable to
food
them.
Has gotten in modern Western society, especially America, food has become it's been so mass produced that we throw away a tremendous amount of food now because we have so much of it. Like people will eat it and buy a bunch and be like, oh, we didn't use that. That went bad. Throw that away. And it's funny because I'll see my grandparents or even my parents who my dad especially who grew up in Sicily was real poor. Like if you throw food away in front of him, like that's a big fucking deal.
That's a slap in the face.
But it's like now it's not a big deal because like who cares? I'll buy more. It's not a big deal. I'll throw it away, right? Yeah. So it's definitely changed our behaviors in that sense. So I think respecting our food probably will go a long way. And the other thing too is like we vote with our dollars. Like if you spend more money on foods that are, you know, farmed within, you know, a particular way that, you know, are maybe organic, don't have, you know, high pesticide, you know, residue, whatever, you're going to create a larger market demand for products like that. And producers, you know, this is the beauty of the market, producers will find better ways to make these things. They'll become less expensive and more accessible. Mm. And we're already starting to see some of that, you know, so take your dollars and vote.
Well, this is part of what, you know, took us for a long time too to even connect with sponsors is, mm-hmm. you know, there was tons of companies at the beginning that were, you know, doing supplements or drinks or whatever else company we got hit up with that did not run everything organically. And it was like, man, I really like what you guys are doing, but if you're not ready to see where this is going in the future, like, and make that change. And I remember us talking to some people that were just stubborn about it, that just don't think that there's going
to
be.
Yeah, and they're not malicious about it. Like, they're not, like, the intent is to produce and produce something of high quality, but they're not, like, considering all the factors and really forward thinking about how this is going to affect us long term. And
well, marginally, it doesn't make sense right now, right?
It's way expensive.
A lot of people, I mean, right. and I see people all the time, like, complain about certain products that. Or, oh my God, it's so expensive. It's like, well, yeah, no, if you care about that, then right now it's not set in place for it to compete with somebody who's mass producing it on farms. It just can't. Like you, it's just logical. It's not like you shouldn't, as a consumer, I think it's so unfair to bitch about, oh my God, it's so much more expensive than I just bought.
Super high quality, but we want it super, super cheap.
Because it's that attitude that got us in the place we are right now.
Yeah,
because like you said, we vote with our dollars and we have shown that that's more important to us, that we can save $20 or $10 on something versus, hey, I'm willing to spend a little bit more money to know that this is coming from a much better place than this other thing, even though they're similar, what it may be giving me for my goal to get build muscle or burn body fat or whatever that, or get whatever nutrient, you know, major macronutrient I'm looking for. I don't know. I'm willing to spend a little more money to know for sure where it's coming from.
And again, this is why you're seeing, you know, it wasn't that long ago that, you know, the people who were poor or the disenfranchised suffered from diseases of lack of food. They were starving. They didn't have enough food. They would die as a result of it. Now the poor and disenfranchised suffer from chronic disease and obesity at much higher rates.
This is what excites me about the whole model with Thrive Market.
I was just going there.
Yeah, is what they're doing is not only is it cool to see this direction, but also the potential of how many people they could be impacting.
Yeah.
I mean, when you start doing things where they're actually putting out competitive prices, they found another way to beat the system in a sense.
Yeah, they're driving the market in that direction.
It's pretty fucking
awesome.
That's
why we want to vote on that.
Bottom line is if Thrive Market does well, which if they do well, it's because they deserve it. If they do bad, it's because they didn't do a good job. That's just the way the market works. But if they do well, it's because the demand is there. They're providing good prices. better prices for products that we're talking about that are better for you. So if they do well and they continue to grow, what it's going to do, it's going to draw more competitors into the market that are going to try to do the same thing or something similar. Now, that may be bad news for companies like Thrive because now they have to compete, but it's great news for consumers like us because now we have more choices, more options, and more. Look, these big, these massive food manufacturers, you know, General Mills and all these companies that make all this food, they, if they see the market going in that direction, that's where they're going to invest their time and money. And trust me, they have the means to figure out ways to do things so that we can still get things for good prices, but get them in, you know, get better products.
Well, a lot
products.
Of them, I hear that a lot of them are parlaying, right? I hear a lot of companies, and I wish I had examples.
They're hedging, aren't they?
Yeah, that are hedging their bets where they either, one, have another department or a part of the company that's starting to build out the organic side and go that direction, and they just don't market it that much. And or that are buying other,
they're absorbing other companies,
other companies, and they just keep they just keep that name. You know what I'm saying? So they let it run with that name, but it's really owned by a big corporation.
Coca-Cola, all these big companies.
I was at Safeway the other day, and I saw Foster Farms organic chicken now. Foster Farms, like the major producer of chicken,
That's like has a whole chicken company.
They now have organic, their own organic know, section of chicken.
That's exciting.
Yeah, so it's just because the market's starting to respond.
What was it that just, what were, the, I remember, I know there's a lot of people that crack on that too because the standards in what gets something to pass as organic.
So here's what I think. I think the first phase is to get more organic, responsible farming, that whole category of foods to grow in terms of the market share
before it becomes competitive.
And then the quality of it within that, you're going to see more and more transparency. Because then when you have all these companies that are competing with organic products, good farming, whatever, and now that you're competing and the prices start to drop, it's going to become who does it better, who's got more, who's got better standards. Look, we have 24-hour cameras on our farms that you can watch and you can see. Look, we have independent lab tests.
The quality
that show,
of life of these chickens.
It'll get more and more like Whole Foods just got bought by Amazon. It's obviously going to keep growing and exploding. Who's going to replace Whole Foods? And what I mean by that is Whole Foods used to be the niche, kind of posh, place to buy food if you were really health conscious. Well, now that their prices are going to start dropping and they're going to start, what's going to replace them? What's going to replace them? And I was thinking about this last night. I'm like, I bet you stores are going to open up where you're going to go in. Nothing's going to be packaged. It's all going to be in these massive containers and it's going to be bulk. Everything in bulk. You come in with your own jars, your own bags, and they're going to advertise like no waste product. We're not going to produce any waste. Everything's bulk or I bet you're going to start seeing some craziness like that where it's almost going to feel like you're
straight
going,
off the truck from a farm.
Yeah, where you're going to go back in time almost.
I already see the rise. I remember being a kid and not ever really seeing a farmer's market. Like the whole idea of a farmer's market.
They're everywhere now.
They're everywhere. Yeah. You can find one almost anywhere these days on almost any day of the week where in the past, think about when you were a kid. I don't remember ever seeing a farmer's market when I was a kid. I didn't start seeing them
at the flea market.
Yeah, no.
That was it.
I saw a restaurant that they actually had like their entire garden was right behind it. And, all of their vegetables and all of their salads and everything was grown right behind the restaurant. I was like, wow, that's fucking awesome.
Oh, that's not okay. Orchard City Kitchen's kind of cool where they keep it's a massive, huge refrigerator that you can see through. You can see all their fresh vegetables that they literally just came in. So you can tell. You can tell it just came straight from the farm.
I'm telling you, it's becoming a selling point.
Oh, man. It's one of the hottest restaurants for sure in our town.
I'll go there. Yeah.
Yeah. No,
they put that kind of effort into it.
Excellent. Well, we started off with bad news, but we've got good news. So just people are more informed. I'm happy about that. Some of these studies are starting to come out that are going to start proving what we've been talking about. And we'll see what happens. We're pretty resilient.
Well, this is also what excited me about, the finishing up of the intuitive guide too, was, this is really, we're getting beyond this, just macro counting weight loss, weight gain strategy. And let's start learning how to teach ourselves to make better choices. And it's a process and it's okay. It's not demonizing food. It's not saying you'll never open something out of a wrapper one day or drink a diet soda or do something like that. It's not that at all. It's just becoming more aware of the things that become habits in your life. And I know that people struggle with it because I know I fucking still struggle with it. I find at times, I just caught myself doing this the other day. So I love those fucking Quest bars. And, I in and out, I'll have them. And then all of a sudden I'll catch myself wanting two or three of them in a day. Mm. I'll go from never having them. I remember every time this happens, the first bite of me having it after I haven't had it for a long time, I actually don't even really like it that much, but I still eat it. Mm. And then by the second or the third time I have one, they now all of a sudden taste different. They taste way better.
Oh shit.
And then I go from them tasting better than to me wanting two of them, sometimes even three of them in a day before. And it's like, I totally am aware of what's happening. And I know in the past I wasn't, you know, it was just something like, because in my head I'm going, oh, it's a protein bar, it's healthy for me. But it's just a confirmation of how it's designed to hijack that. And all of a sudden, the next thing you know, I find myself craving them and wanting them all the time. And I see the same patterns with Diet Cokes, things like that. So, and again, these things still make their way in and out of my life. I think the point is becoming aware of it.
Yeah, just stopping in that moment and realizing, right, is this going to benefit me, or, you know, is this something that I should, you know, look elsewhere for something else? You know, like, I think that we just get caught up in the ritual and the routine of our day, and it's like, oh, let's just shove this in real quick.
And what matters is that, and it's not so much that's bad about the diet soda or what's bad about the bar when I do that, is what I also realize is I don't get other things in my diet that I start to miss the things that are really beneficial. If there's times that I'm missing my greens for the day, it's because I was on the go and I ate one or two bars. You know, I just fasted, and then when I finally ate, I just had a bar, no big deal. And so it's not so much what's so bad about the bar or what's not ideal about that. It's the what I didn't do to get inside my body. And then that's the best thing my body got over the last 48 hours is this bar, you know, like, so I think it's becoming just more aware of that versus demonizing things that, you know, are not ideal.
Well, what gives me a little hope is when you look at the success that we had with cigarettes, and we have had tremendous success in this country.
Have we? I was actually just thinking about it the other day.
God, the amount that people smoke today versus how much they smoked 40, 50 years ago, drastically lower, much lower. And it's because people now associate smoking with, you know, bad breath, yellow teeth, you know, it's gross or whatever. Whereas 50 years ago, it was cool. Like, if you smoked, it was cool.
James Dean was doing it.
Yeah, you looked really cool. And so that perception of a shift. Now, people still smoke. It's still addicting. It still feels good. But because the perception around it shifted, that made a big impact on, you know, in terms of public opinion and how much people smoked. I think we can do that with food. I think we're starting to see the beginning of it, but it's going to take a while, I think. It's going to take a long time. Just like I did with cigarettes, it took decades before we started to see a real impact from, you know, our campaign against.
That's why I was at the first question I asked you when we first started talking about all this is, you know, sure, this information comes out, and sure, we feel like in our little circle that people are making healthier choices, but we already know that podcast listeners are already higher IQs. These are already growth-minded people. Like, so yeah, in our little circle, you see people trying to make that, but in the masses, I feel like...
Isn't that interesting that we can shame somebody smoking a cigarette, but not somebody like overweight and stuffing in like a fucking disgusting burger?
Well, check this out. I just looked it up. Statistic. In 1965,
yeah, it is funny,
the smoking rate among adults, I didn't realize this, 65, 42%. 42% of American adults smoked. In 2014, 16.8%. That's a big difference.
That's a big improvement.
That's a success. Mm. That's a big success. But it took from 1965 to 2014. And it isn't food.
Well,
food you have to have.
Here's the irony.
Yeah.
Here's the irony in that. Cancer is on the rise, right?
Cancer is...
You took out one small fraction.
Well, you know, I think most people used to connect cigarettes to cancer.
That was the
anti-campaign forever was cigarettes cause cancer. And so I think a lot of people just assumed that it was everything, all cancers that we were getting were caused by this.
Saw the pandemonium with that, you know, that was like super fear that was like spreading out. And we don't see any of that with food.
Right.
Yeah, that's great. I know lung cancer rates have gone down, but other types of cancers have gone up. So yeah, the news is not too good with our health. And it's definitely not...
It's an understatement.
And it's not our lack of medicine that's causing it. It's not our lack of advanced
or knowledge.
Techniques. Yeah.
You know, it's like that's what blows my mind is that,
dude, we're too insecure.
There are certain things about our culture that is fascinating to me, like our ability to evolve and educate. Like when I look at, and I geek out on this, like when I was watching football last night, And to see how much the sport has progressed in my short 20 years of being a fan is fucking phenomenal. It's unbelievable when you see how we've evolved. Like 20 years ago, the athletes just didn't even move on the field the way they move on the field now. And I saw that with my own eyes now. It's because I have this, I vividly remember as a kid watching football and incredible. Basketball and seeing them now, and to think how much we've evolved. And then learning and education, like with the ability now right through our phone and like Googling stuff and TED Talks, like you see these things that we progress in so fast, and Western medicine, all the things that we have created. But then you have this other area where we're regressing. It's crazy to me that all these other areas of our lives, we evolve and we better ourselves so much, but for some reason we struggle with this food one. And I wonder if it's because in the grand scheme of things, my 20 years is nothing. The last 100 years is nothing, right? Yeah. The last 500 years is still really nothing in the whole grand scheme of things. And is it because we haven't really lived that long in abundance?
I think it's because we have a lot of counter information with food. Cigarettes initially did. Initially, the tobacco industry was spending a lot of money on scientists and research.
To say things like, oh, it was healthy.
Yeah, to say cigarettes, oh, no, they're not addictive. They don't cause cancer and all this other stuff. But then eventually everybody agreed. And it was pretty quick. The U.S. government came out. Everybody agreed, like, okay, cigarettes cause cancer. Cigarettes are bad. Now with food, if you think the cigarette lobby group was powerful, that doesn't even come close to the power of these mega food producing corporations, you know, wheat and corn and these biotech companies that produce, you know, all these pesticides and herbicides and these companies that produce, you know, artificial colors and sweeteners. So here you got these wellness people saying, hey, don't eat that way, eat organic, you know, careful for glass. And then they're coming out and they're saying, no, look at all these studies showing it's safe. And then the U.S. government is in bed with a lot of them. And so you don't see any, like the World Health Organization comes out and says, glyphosates are a probable carcinogen. And right after the U.S. government comes out and says, no, that's wrong. We don't believe them. And it's like, what? Yeah. Like there's some misinformation going around that. Yeah.
Meanwhile, like coconut oil is horrible for you, right?
Yeah, and then you've got people on our side who disagree. You've got people on our side that if I bring this up, they'll be like, no, that's all fine. You know, artificial sweeteners are fine. Those things, you know, glyphosate's not a big deal. We don't have any evidence, and it's like, okay, it has to be so glaringly obvious before.
Yeah,
I think we start to see major change. That's what I think.
Which is scary. It could be long. It could be another 5, 10+ years before that even comes close.
I think it'll happen when it's so in our face we can't even deny it.
It will when it
which will take
to,
a little while.
When it starts to fuck us economically, that's when it's really good.
Yes.
That's when that's when it'll happen. It won't even happen as it continues to rise the way it is percentage wise. It will be when like the amount of debt that we're starting to rack up and then we start to see that this
people
is going, this
will
could
be desperate
fold our economy. Yeah. You know,
once we're desperate enough to try and save money, right? So that's what's going to happen. Everybody, like, there's going to be incentive programs to be healthy and preventative, and like everybody, you know, like it's going to be so expensive that that's like you have to.
It is neat to see some companies getting on board with this. You do see some of these companies.
I can't wait. Yeah,
and I think some of the forward thinkers with the tech companies that we have over here in the Silicon Valley, like they do a lot of stuff that other companies didn't do as far as break times and having little gyms within their workspace. I mean, think about that, like Google, Facebook, Apple, they all have like in facility gyms. Like what other company do you ever
they realize that it benefits their bottom line too.
Yeah.
You have a healthy
the retention rates. I mean, you just look at from a numbers perspective, like they can go through and be like, oh wow, this is benefiting productivity and retention and all these other markets.
And my insurance rates are going down, all this stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's cost effective.
Mm-hmm. Check it out. Go to YouTube, Mind Pump TV. Subscribe to our channel. We've got a new video every single day.
You got to check out the anti-rotational series that Justin and I just did. It was a killer series. Everybody should incorporate this.
That was a fun one.
Anti-rotation.
Yeah. I'm anti against it.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.